Hello and welcome back to the Visionary Mindset Podcast. Today we have Jeremy McNeill, my man. He's going to share a little bit about his journey, where he came from and where he's at now. So tell the audience what you've been up to.
Well, first off, thanks for having me on, Matt. I know the work you do is fantastic, and you're not only a great person, but you're great at what you do. So it's nice to be on a nice show and just talk and hang out. This is cool, man.
Yeah, it's fun.
But I'm in real estate. I'm a realtor here in the area. I grew up in Sacramento, East Sac, lived there for a long time. I live out in Roseville now, and my office is in Folsom. And real estate's what I do, man. And it's a business, as you know, where it's 24/7, yep. Pretty much 8 to 8, sometimes a little longer than that at night. But yeah, the phone starts ringing at 8 and that's how it goes.
Yeah. Well, where did you start? So let's walk us through from the beginning, you know, growing up did you always have your eyes on real estate?
Oh, no.
What was your journey?
Yeah, I don't think anyone ever has their eyes on real estate. I feel like nobody ever really has their eyes even on sales. Mm-hmm. I feel like sales is kind of a career that you just end up in. Real estate's just a career you end up in. I mean, I'm sure there's some people who grow up and they're like, oh, I want to be a realtor when I grow up, or oh, I want to be a real estate investor.
They have family and sales or something, and they work in the family business. But
that wasn't me for sure. But looking back, like, I did have some good sales stories, I guess you could say. When I was 4 years old, my mom helped me set up a lemonade stand. And what I would do is I'd go out there for like 2 hours, make like 40 or 50 bucks, and then just go to the store and buy a Game Boy game.
Nice.
And then I would just shut the shop down and, you know, maybe do it again the next day. But
yeah,
I didn't really have a mindset at that point because I was so young to save money. It was like, hey, I'm just going to make money, go out and blow it.
Right.
Then the older I got, I was doing car washes in my neighborhood. So I was probably like 11 or 12. And I'd go around the neighborhood, I'd knock on my neighbor's door and I'd say, hey, I'm going around the neighborhood trying to make some money, save some money up. Do you want your car washed? Some people would say no, some would say yeah. And if they did, they'd say, hey, what do you charge? And I'd say, I don't have a set price. I'm fine with whatever you're comfortable paying.
Nice.
So that usually worked.
Sometimes
to my benefit.
That's a better approach, right?
Yeah. Oh yeah. Sometimes someone would throw you a 20.
Yeah.
Sometimes someone would skimp you and give you like $3.
Dude, but what?
Can you imagine just ripping
for
a 12-year-old off?
Bro?
Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah. So, hey man, it's okay. You know, I made some decent money from that. I'd usually save up enough to go buy a new phone or something like that. So, that's what I did, man. I grew up playing a lot of soccer.
Nice.
I feel like a lot of people who are in sales grow up playing a sport
because
they kind of have like a competitive drive. So I loved soccer. I played that all the way up until I was 19. Tried out for a few pro teams, man. Ended up not having a huge love for soccer. I really, really liked it, but I didn't have the love for it or want for it to continue playing. And it wasn't going to provide me with the lifestyle financially that I wanted.
Right.
Soccer players here in the U.S. don't make a whole lot of money.
No.
I'm sure you know, but they don't.
Yeah. No, but some of the points that you were talking about with growing up with your lemonade stand.
Mm-hmm.
So what I did is my parents got me a snow cone machine when I was super young. And
ooh.
So that was kind of my little hustle, my
very cool
intro to entrepreneurship. We lived on a court in Cameron Park, right by Cameron Park Lake. And so during the summers, it was popping, right?
Oh, I
you
bet.
Know, I mean, I didn't do it all the time, but there would be weekends where I'd go out there with my snow cone machine and make like $20.
Heck yeah.
I mean, my parents paid for the you know, the supplies and the overhead a little bit, but whatever, you know,
worked
out. but yeah, we would have big parties in the summer. For 4th of July, they have the Summer Spectacular.
Nice.
And, you know, I'd have a day where I'd, you know, get like $100 with everybody coming through, and then I'd go and buy a video game.
Mm-hmm.
So that was my little hustle in the beginning.
As a kid, that's such a great hustle. And I think if you have kids, it's a great way to show them the value of hard work and the value of a dollar. Because a lot of kids don't have that. I don't care if you grow up poor, if you grow up rich, middle class, whatever.
Right.
A lot of people, it takes them a long time to figure out the value of a dollar. And I think when you're a kid, you know, selling lemonade, you know, what you were selling as well, the snow cones, you really learn how money works. It teaches you how to talk to people young.
Yep.
And it puts you in situations that a lot of younger kids aren't in.
Yep.
Like, how often is a, you know, 6-7-year-old talking to someone? You know,
right.
I know it's like a small deal, but it's only like a dollar.
Yeah,
or two,
I mean,
but
yeah, it's just getting them like, you know, public speaking and just getting them comfortable with, you know, talking with people. That's huge, which is very interesting because I was good at that when I was younger, mm-hmm. but then I went through a phase where I was not good with public speaking. It wasn't into, it was like, I turned, I would say, probably the end of middle school through high school. Well, that's kind of the time that I stopped sports too. So okay. that might kind of play into what you were talking about earlier, but mm-hmm. I kind of stopped sports at the end of middle school. And that's when I got the passion for media. So I was doing a lot more stuff alone. So I wasn't out and about doing entepreneurial things and, you know, interacting with sports teams and stuff like that. So I don't mm-hmm. think I was around people as much. But it wasn't until college was when I started, you know, doing better with talking with people, just in general. So
I feel like talking to people, public speaking, even just like normal, like social interactions, it's kind of like going to the gym or a habit. Like the more you do it, the better you're going to be.
Right.
And the more secluded you are, you know, you're going to be worse at talking to people. I think everyone probably at least has somewhat of a fear of talking in front of people.
Yeah.
To an extent. Or even just random people. It's hard to go up to a random person you don't know and to start talking to them.
Yeah.
I mean, I know it's probably not as hard for you now with your business, because you deal with clients from all walks of life, man. You're dealing with realtors. You're dealing with business owners. Like you just said, you were doing a sorority shoot for Sac State, which is cool. I mean, you're in front of God knows how many people doing that. So, you got to be able to turn that social vibe on.
And you have to interact with all these people in different ways mm-hmm. too. You know, you can't. You know, you're not going to be acting all fun and dorky, mm-hmm. you know, in front of the sorority and then doing that in front of a real estate agent that's in their 60s. Like, mm-hmm. no, you got to flip the switch and kind of have different personalities mm-hmm. to be able to interact with these different, walks of life, like you said, and business people. So
that's a huge skill to have. So I had a couple questions for you before we were setting up the podcast.
I wanna hear this.
We were sitting here, Matt and I were talking, and the whole time, like, questions were running through my head, and I was like, I got to save it for the podcast. I already forgot probably like five of them.
Okay.
But one thing I noticed, and it's on your YouTube channel, it's here in your office, which your office is awesome, by the way. I like it a lot.
Thank you.
You have a really distinct branding. Mm. What made you go with yellow?
Yellow. That's interesting. I think I've only had someone ask that like one time. That was a little while ago. But when I decided to create the logo, which actually we're coming up on the 5-year anniversary of DCP.
Congratulations.
thank you. So I switched over the business. I wanted to be more professional. Mm-hmm. I would say I officially started professionally in 2017. So I graduated 2016, moved out of my parents' house in March of 2017, worked as a contractor for a local marketing company, DNet Marketing. It was a job that I got through one of my classes in college. But I was working with him, and I had a very, I would say, unprofessional look to my business as I was approaching it. So I was like, okay, I need to come up with a name and a brand that I can start building around rather mm-hmm. than, I didn't want it to be more personal. There's a lot of like people in media now that are doing it like solely themselves. So mm-hmm. it'll be like, you know, Jeremy McNeill's photography, you know, or whatever. Mm-hmm. I wanted something that's just more general mm-hmm. That I can build a bigger brand around that can, you know, scale to a bigger point. Maybe at some point I can even sell the business.
Yeah.
Well, so when I was creating the logo, I was actually talking with one of my friends at the time and somebody that I did business for, Tanner James. He was a DJ, same age. He was super helpful with like me starting. He had a lot of tips and points that I took into account when I was doing certain things. So when I created the logo, I was asking him like, oh, you know, how should I make it look and what color should I mm-hmm. use? And I believe he was the one who mentioned yellow, and yellow has never been like a color that I was like, oh, I love that
color.
Yeah, it's
like your favorite color.
Now it's like one of my favorite colors, mm-hmm. you know, just cause like I have to use it all the time. But yellow, I looked it up. It was just like, yellow represents like positivity and happiness, and you know, it just has a, it just feels like a good good vibe.
Yeah.
I think at the time, like, my favorite color was red.
Okay.
And, like, I just didn't see that as, like, a color that I wanted to brand around.
A lot of companies use red, but I know that has a different meaning, too. I honestly forget what red means for businesses.
You know, at that point, I thought it just was just, like, darker, you know? Like, because they teach, like, the mood, you know, mood colors.
Yeah.
Red just wasn't it, you know?
Sure.
Blue was also another color that I thought about. But, yellow, I just went with it and stuck with it. And I'm happy I did.
Yeah, I was going to say, like, your logo looks great. It stands out. DCP in nice yellow right there. You have it's spelled out below in black. I think it's a nice, simple logo.
Right.
And another thing I think you did that's super, super smart, and a lot of people in real estate, you know, whatever business it is, rely too much on their name, where it's like, you know, Matt's photography business. You know, sure, you might be able to get somewhat big with that locally, but like you said, selling that or trying to make it a larger brand later on, it's going to be a lot more difficult.
Right.
And you see that a lot in real estate, where a lot of people might be like, oh, this is the Jeremy McNeill Group. I would never do something like that. I always think that a lot of people think their name is the brand when it should be the other way around.
Yeah.
The brand should be the brand.
Yeah.
You shouldn't try to make it your name. So I think that's a great decision you made. And it's a good name for your company. I like it. It stands out. It's easy to remember. So I think you made a great decision.
I actually spent like a full day trying to figure out what my name was going to be. And I knew that I was hoping to have some type of, you know, production, cinema in it.
Sure.
The dynamic, I don't even know where that came from.
Mm-hmm.
But when I thought about it, I was like, this sounds amazing. So I was searching all day, like a bunch of names were taken that I thought of, but when I came across this one, and I didn't see anybody that had it,
that's
like nowhere, you know. And some people copy other business names, you know, if they're in other states or whatnot, they can reuse the name and just have different logo and branding. But when I found that name, I was like, this is it, man. Yeah.
That's cool, and
like you said, it's just, it's actually come to a point where there's been certain times where I've gotten inquiries where I don't think I would have gotten them or been able to do them if I hadn't created a business entity. You know, because there's been times where I've gotten weddings and stuff like that, and I'm like, okay, yeah, you reach out to Dynamic Cinema Productions.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I may be running the business solely, but they don't need to know that.
Yeah, they don't.
So there's been times where I'll get an inquiry, I go to someone else, and I say, hey, I have an opportunity here. What do you charge for this? This is what I'll be able to compensate you. Maybe it's even higher than the rate that they would charge, and it's just a win-win situation.
Yeah.
I get to do a job even though I may not be available, and someone locally can help out
and
still get compensation for, you know, for some work. So
that's smart.
Yeah.
And the name is just, it makes things bigger and larger and grander. Unless you're some giant celebrity where it's like Joe Rogan, where it's like his podcast is the Joe Rogan Experience. Yeah, you can use his name because that's who he is. But like, it's a lot harder for like an average Joe, so to speak, to just start off with their name with a company. Like, that's not going to work.
Totally. Yeah.
Like, it's not Bill Gates Computers, dude. It's Microsoft.
Right.
Like,
exactly.
I think you made, once again, a great decision on that, man.
Thank you. Did you have any other questions that you still remember from...
I know I had it. That was like the big question that was kind of burning.
I like
I know I have a couple other ones. Another thing I wanted to ask was, so here it is. Now it's coming back to me. So you have a crew here already. You have a team. How big do you want to take this? Where do you see it going? Where do you want it to go?
So it's very difficult.
Mm-hmm.
It's very difficult to not only start a business, to keep it running, but then to take the next step and build a team.
Mm-hmm.
And that's been kind of the Achilles heel the last couple of years, is finding the right people to fit into roles that you need and that can propel you forward. So, you know, obviously DCP, our business, our foundation is working with real estate. But I want personally, I want to venture into higher productions, different types of work, stuff like that. So I don't want to just quit on real estate mm-hmm. and some of the things that we have built up, because there's still so much growth potential. Yeah. It like in real estate, I feel like we have barely tapped into what we can do. I mean, I remember looking at a statistic, I think it was last year, maybe the year before, and it was stating all of the listings that went live in each of Placer, El Dorado, and Sacramento mm-hmm. counties. And it was like several hundred per month.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're talking thousands each year in each of the counties. That's a lot.
Yeah, that's a lot of business.
I believe last year we killed it in real estate. I mean, in my eye, we killed it in real estate. But we only did like 365 homes.
That's still really solid, dude. 365, yeah. You're doing one a day.
Yeah.
Yeah. I know you have high expectations. We both do. I feel like that's why we get along so well. But right. That's solid, man. You got to give yourself some credit. But yeah. I'm completely with you. I mean, real estate right now seems to almost be kind of like trendy, which is odd. And I feel like the reason why it's been trendy the past couple of years is because the market was crazy hot. For the past two years.
Everybody talks about it as an investment, and yeah.
Yeah.
It's just a hot topic.
And then you have a lot of people like going on getting their license. I've had people hit me up on Instagram through YouTube, and they've been like, hey, like, you know, I see you're in real estate. Like, I'm thinking of getting into it. And a lot of people think it's easy, fast money.
Mm-hmm.
Dude, it is not. Like, it is, mind you, sure, there might be some transactions that are easier than others, but yeah, it's difficult. Your first year is probably going to be awful. Just like with your business, your first year was probably looking back, probably awful compared to where you are now.
Yeah.
Probably a lot of long days, hard days, a lot of days where you're thinking about quitting.
Mm-hmm.
I can't tell you how many times I've thought about like, man, is real estate worth it? Yeah, it is worth it. But there's some days where you probably question it.
Yeah. 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 So the foundation obviously is real estate. I want to, there's so much potential.
Mm-hmm.
There's just 365 homes. I know there's obviously other companies that are fulfilling these other needs.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that some of these other people and companies that we can do a better job and provide a better service than them, but we just haven't tapped into the market. And credit to me not having to do any advertising. I haven't done any advertising in probably the last two and a half years. Which has kept me busy, but see, like adding people onto my team, if I can start putting people in the right place and feel solid about certain things, and we have a good system, then there comes to a point where okay, now I'm gonna start advertising and start figuring out how we can draw in more business so that you know we can grow, man, like. There's just so much potential. It's just a matter of seeing what can work. But personally, I want to kind of take a step back, be more on the leadership end of the business, and start building a team to, you know, just fill all these different roles. Obviously, we do more than just real estate. We're, you know, we're doing a lot of stuff for businesses and. Just content building for individuals and doing weddings, and you know, we do everything.
You guys do it all.
Yeah. And I don't want to have to do that at some point. I would rather just niche down on certain things. We're kind of phasing out of weddings a little bit. Mm-hmm. So we raised our prices just to do less a year. Mm-hmm. You know, weddings were good the first few years, but just trying to phase out of that a little bit. I really want to get into more travel, tourism, documentary style work.
Where was it you just went?
Portugal. Portugal, okay. Yeah, so that's one thing that's actually going to be released soon is Visit Azores
video. I saw you post some stuff on Instagram, and I was like, that looks pretty sick.
Dude, it's going to be really good. Like, we have high hopes for it.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to pitch it. We're going to pitch it to the tourism boards over there and see.
Very nice.
Yeah, some big tourism boards. So we'll see if something happens. It could be like a life-changing thing if something, you know, something bites. But
well, I'm glad you mentioned that, because that leads into what else I wanted to ask you earlier. So right now, like, you do a ton of business in Northern California, or just the state of California in general. So it sounds like you eventually want DCP to go global. or as big as possible? Or
I mean, I definitely want to go into different states. Mm-hmm. I've tried to make connections online in a couple other states. My sister lives in Idaho.
Okay.
So I've tried to make some connections out there. Nothing's gone through yet.
Mm-hmm. Yet.
Yeah. Well, though. But that reminds me of to a point where I think probably within the next year or so, I definitely want to try and travel to other states with the goal in mind of I'm going out there and I'm going to try and promote DCP in these other states. So whether that's making a connection, via Instagram and doing something for cheap or free, mm-hmm. whatever.
Just to get your name out there.
Just go out there, be like, hey, I'm going to come out here this time to this time if you need anything done, and just see if I can start getting the name out there, you know? And then there comes to a point where I reach out to local creatives and mm-hmm. and see if we can, you know, form some type of contract or agreement, and I give them the systems I have in place and see if we can start, you know, building in other locations. That's always been a long-term goal of mine. Mm-hmm. But obviously gotta build local, mm-hmm. get a team set up local, and then take the next move forward, because I would love to travel for work too.
Yeah,
I love traveling, amazing. So yeah, if I can go to other states and check on some of my team and some of the agents or whoever we're working with out there, then mm-hmm. I'd love to do that, make a trip out of it, you know.
Well, that's what I love about your business too, man, is there's no limits to your business. There is zero limits. You can market any business, any person, any activity, whether it's golf, a lawyer, someone right. who's into cars. There's truly no limit. I know you said you wanted to niche down at a certain point, but you might be surprised at who you end up meeting.
Right.
Especially when you put your stuff on Instagram, TikTok, whatever, dude. You might be surprised who sees it.
Right.
Then they're like, hey, Matt, you know, can you fly out to New York? We have, I'm a trainer for the New York Yankees or yeah. something. Next thing you know, you're taking a video or photos for Aaron Judge. I yep. mean, that's not impossible.
No.
It's
no.
not.
Yeah. No, it's true. I mean, just thinking about like real estate, I didn't know it was going to turn into like that being like the main thing that mm-hmm. I do when I started. Like the only reason I started in real estate in the first place is because I had a guy from high school. His dad was a realtor. And when mm-hmm. I was at Consumnus River one day, and I was working for that, marketing company that I was telling you about. Mm-hmm. And I was sitting in my car after school, and I was thinking, I need to make more money. Like, I want to start making more money.
Yeah.
And I was working with him every now and then, but I was like, dude, I have some money saved up. I can buy some equipment. Like, what can I do? Mm-hmm. Like, what can I do? So I was thinking of, okay, what's some possibilities? What are some types of media that I could get into? And real estate, like, I don't know. I mm-hmm. hadn't ever thought of that, but it just popped into my mind that day after school. And so I reached out to his dad that day, and I think I started working with him like that next
That's
week.
That's awesome.
I was doing stuff for super cheap, and obviously my content was horrible compared to what it is now, but mm-hmm. that started a relationship that has grown and exploded into all these chain reactions yeah. of opportunities and, you know, business. And like the only reason I went out to Portugal was because my agent's parents live there, and so they said, oh, you know, here's a place to stay. So we went out there, I captured content for their home, and then in the process we spent 5 days creating a tourism video
and had a but little vacation like, in the mix.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Yeah, super super fun. The food, drinks, like everything is super cheap there. Like
really,
really cheap. Yeah. We got a whole breakfast, like 3 pastries, 2 coffees, and then like another drink or something, mm-hmm. and it was $6.
Oh my god.
$6.
Yeah, you're getting one coffee.
One coffee here. For that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So anyway, Portugal. Visit yeah,
Portugal
visit,
doesn't
visit
sound
Azores.
Too bad.
Visit Azores. But yeah, I mean, just the opportunities, you know, you just take one. And that's another thing, is like, why I don't want to niche too early, mm-hmm. because there is opportunities where maybe you don't realize, yeah. you know. So, yeah, I mean, if I had never jumped into real estate, I don't even know where my life would be, you know.
Well, what you said when you were sitting in your car at Cosumnes, that is a true entrepreneur's mind. Mm-hmm. I need to make money. Maybe you don't even need it. Maybe you just want it. Yeah. It's like, I want something better. I want something more important. I want to be something. I want to create something. And that's what you did. Yep. Entrepreneurs have that mindset. I think that's a gift and a curse at times.
Right.
Because I feel like as an entrepreneur, you're always
going
like,
to do this,
I want to do that. Yeah.
You're never satisfied. It's
never.
Yeah.
it's a problem, kind of, but kind of not a problem. It's something I've been trying to work on, where it's like you're never satisfied, but you're always trying to get the next thing. And it's like this weird balance.
Right. Right. Well, okay. So let's go into a little bit about your
sure.
journey in real estate. So when did you start?
I started in 2019.
Okay, so, that's right.
Yeah, that's when I got my license. So I had also tried college out.
Yep.
And I wasn't happy there. I never really liked school.
Yeah.
I barely graduated high school. I think I passed or graduated enough like by one class. Like I literally barely graduated.
Yeah.
Had tried community college out. It was Folsom Lake College.
Okay.
And real estate, like I remember my grandparents, I think, had asked about it once because I have a cousin she's been doing it for like 18, 19 years now. And she's done pretty well for herself. But I just tried to think of ways that I could make money,
yep.
Something that I could build. And like I said, I never grew up like wanting to be in real estate. It had never even crossed my mind. I didn't really know what I wanted to do. So college wasn't working out for me. And I'd wanted to get my real estate license, and I ended up doing it with one of my buddies. We were both like, dude, we need to make some money. We had this little like landscape business on the side that we were doing, nice. And it was cool for extra money and stuff. But, we got our license, and I had studied a decent amount for it. It's not like you're taking the bar, dude. It's,
yeah,
you know,
right.
But don't get me wrong. I wasn't familiar. I didn't even know what escrow was before I got my license, dude. Dead serious.
That's crazy.
And, I ended up passing first try. I ended up getting on at a brokerage, and you'll get, once you pass your test, I'm sure you know with your lady, but
yep.
you just get bombarded with like letter after letter
oh,
after
yeah,
letter from
did.
All these brokerages.
Yeah.
And it's like,
she already knew where she was going mm-hmm. because I introduced her to someone, but yeah, she was bombarded.
I bet. For like weeks,
yeah.
maybe even months, they yeah. just keep hitting you.
Yeah.
But, I ended up finding a brokerage. It was EXP Realty at the time. And I was pretty much trying to do it on my own with my buddy. And like looking back, like I was like 22, I thought I was invincible. I was like, oh, I can do this. All I have to do is work hard. And like, I tried to learn a lot through YouTube, and looking back, I should have just gone under someone immediately, mm-hmm. but I was very stubborn and stupid. And things didn't work out too well. It was like 6 months of me doing it. We had only closed like two deals. I had a couple listings fall out of contract. And yeah. what I was doing is I was just doing open houses, like 3-4 a week. I was hitting up FSBOs, for sale by owners. And this was 2019, so the market was different than it is now. It wasn't as crazy. Like homes would sit, and like it's not like it was the past 2 years.
Right.
So the market was different. And yeah, I was just trying to get everything off like sweat equity, dude. Like I didn't really know what I was doing, but was able to close a couple deals, and I was like, man, this is not working out. Like I'm gonna bleed myself dry. So
yeah.
I ended up getting a job at, and this was like the biggest ego hit of my life. And I ended up getting a job at Sprint, dude, the phone place.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And like T-Mobile bought them out, and then it was T-Mobile, whatever. But I still obviously had my real estate license. But I needed to go there and start stacking some money up. So went there. I was there for, I ended up being there for like a year and a half.
Oh, wow.
Had only closed a single deal while I was there. I was still trying to do business. But when you're working a 9-to-5,
yeah.
it's not Hard. Realistic to
yeah.
do that. And like I was doing like 40-something hours a week, 40 hours, whatever.
Yeah.
And it's hard to do real estate. Like you, if you're not in real estate full time,
yep.
you are not going to succeed at it. I've never seen a successful part-time agent. And that's, I'll get to where I'm at now. But now that I've been doing it full time for a long time, mm. now it's like second nature. It's like you have to be in this business full time. But long story short,
right.
I was there for a little while, had only closed a deal, and it was a deal out in Folsom, and it was my friend's mom. So I was thankful for that, and because I was still not very experienced. Like I was, but I wasn't.
Yeah.
night and day from what it is now. But I started reaching out to agents because I was like, dude, I need to get out of this job. I was like, I'm depressed. This is a dead end job. The money wasn't terrible. It was hourly and you'd get commission, but you'd cap at like a certain amount of commission for the month. So it was like just enough to keep certain people happy there and they'd get stuck. And you know, that was just a dead end job.
Right.
And I was like, I need to start hitting people up. So I went on Instagram and like I had connections with other agents and stuff. And I hit this one agent up. He's up in El Dorado Hills. And I think he's only like 3 years older than me, 2-3 years.
Oh, wow.
And I DM'd him and I was like, hey, man, I explained my whole situation. I was like, are you free for a phone call? Like, it looks like you're doing great. Like, he's like, yeah, of course, man. And like, I just got done working out at the gym. We got on the phone and we talked for like over an hour. And he told me about his journey. And it was very similar to mine, where he started, failed, got a job at, he got like a job at like a Verizon. And it seems like it's a common thread. Yeah. And then he was in real estate doing that and he was killing it. And so we talked and I was like, dude, I need a mentor. Like at this point, I want to pay the cost. You got to pay the cost to be the boss. And like, I didn't care what it was. I just needed to be in a real estate office. I didn't care if I was basically like picking up trash. Like I just needed to be there and learn. And because I knew like at this point I'd sank so much time into it, I had to be successful at this. I always knew I'd be successful at it. I just didn't know it would take as long as it did. And he ended up getting me in touch with a couple people. And one was very responsive. And that's where I'm at now. It was Robert Yost at Prime Real Estate. And
the man.
Yeah, he's awesome, dude. Like I'm very, very thankful for everything he's helped me with and given me. And dude, I mean, shout out to Ryan. Ryan was the one who got me in contact with Robert and Prime. I went there for an interview and I sat down with him and his wife, Angie.
Yep.
And they're like, hey, look, like you're super green. Like you've only closed a few deals. They're like, do you want to quit your job and start working here? And I was like, yeah, I'm down. I'll literally quit my job today, right now. And like bounce. Yeah. I was like, I hate my job. Like, I was like, I want to do this. So I was like, and this was probably cocky of me too, but I remember saying like, I know I'm capable of being the best here at the office. Before I even had this, I hadn't even closed like 5 or 10 houses. Right. I think it was literally like 3 or 4.
You said that?
And I was like, I'm capable of being the number one person here. Mm-hmm. I said that. And I've always been very confident in myself, whether that was sports, I always knew I was the best player on the field. Right. You have to have that mindset that you're the best.
Yep.
And that's what I said to him. I was like, hey, I know it doesn't really look like it, but I guarantee you I will outwork every person in this office. I will do it. I will be number one. And they said, hey, you know, I don't think right now is a good time for you to be an agent full time here, just with everything that you need to learn. You're very green. They're like, we see you have a ton of drive. We like you. And they offered me a salary position.
Oh, wow.
And I was like, awesome. This is good enough money where I'll quit my job.
Yeah.
I get to be in an office. I get to be around these agents who have been doing really well and just be in that environment. And being around that environment and seeing other people win, seeing other people do it, being around like-minded people, not at some dead-end job,
right,
will inspire you and make you great. So I did that role for like 5 months. Mm-hmm. And they had said, you know, hey, you're not stuck in this salary position. Like you can get out of this position whenever you want. Just tell us when you're ready. Mm. They're like, but we don't want to push you. But like, make sure you're comfortable.
Right.
And they
that's
gave,
amazing. That's awesome.
I was able to shadow agents. Yeah. I was able to listen in on listing appointments, go to appointments, do showings for other agents. I did a lot of admin work. I got to do a lot of stuff with contracts. And like a lot of this stuff I was like semi-familiar with, but I was really, really owning it at this point. And once again, somewhat of an ego hit, but I was glad to be out of a dead end job. But right. Once again, even in this assistant position, I was like, I know I'll be the best person here. It's just a matter of time.
But I mean, getting a salary position and doing all those things, that doesn't happen a lot, I feel like, right?
I'm like, I don't even have words for it, dude. It was amazing.
Yeah.
Like I'm so beyond thankful for that.
Because a lot of those things that you just mentioned are just sweat equity.
Mm-hmm.
It's just like getting started, you know?
Yeah.
And so that's amazing opportunity.
It was fantastic. I got paid every 2 weeks. They let me do some agent activities. Like it was awesome, dude. It was great. Like they were like, hey, if you need to ever take time off, you can.
Wow.
Like it was perfect and they really cared about me. And that's what you need in real estate. If you're an agent or thinking about becoming a realtor and wanting to get into the business, there's going to be a ton of people out there who are going to, if you have a pulse, they'll hire you at their office.
Yeah.
Make sure. Unfortunately, it's what it is.
That's like car sales.
Seriously, it is. Make sure you find someone that truly cares about you and that you can benefit them as well. It's not going to be a one-sided thing where you're just like, they're handing you tons of leads. Like, you have to help them out too, which right. I was able to do that, where it was a win-win for both of us. They helped me out, I helped them out, right? So I ended up taking the jump after like 5 months, and I'm out where I'm at now, man. Like, all the experience I gained has helped me become a lot more polished. I know the ins and the outs. And it's great, man. I'm super happy with where I'm at right now. I'm not content because I still have not reached my goals, but for this year, I already broke what my yearly goal was four or five months into the year, which is awesome. Yeah, felt good.
That's so sick.
But it's never good enough, as you know. And eventually I want to get to the point where, sure, I'm still selling a lot of real estate and helping families buy and sell and move, relocate, but I also want to have my own portfolio of rental properties. Yep. So I know you're that same way, bro.
I'm there, man. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm not there.
You will be.
I still
got to
get my first property. Mm-hmm. That's in the works right now. You know, paid off some debt, and just working to build up some money in the business and the saving, and moved out of our apartment. Kind of living with my parents right now.
There's nothing wrong with that.
No,
man.
Oh no. You're not even close.
That is the best decision to make.
Yeah.
A lot of people, I don't know what it is. I feel like it's an American thing where people are like, yeah, living with your parents, you got to get out of there like 19, 20. Dude, I lived with my parents for a while.
Yeah.
And, you know,
unless there's a bad tension in your relationship, then like, why would you not?
But I will say that not a lot of people have that relationship with their parents, or they don't have a family they can do that with.
Right.
So I feel like we're very lucky that we had that opportunity.
Right. Yeah. So that's the goal, man. I want to, and that goes into like the business too, is if I can build up properties, and have a portfolio where it's paying for my lifestyle, then I can focus on some things in the business that I want to focus more on, you know, and I can fuel more money into the business and grow that much quicker. So that's a step in the process. It'll be, you know, a few years down the line, and having Diana too, and having her on the same page, and now that she's in real estate too, that'll
help.
It's gonna be good.
She can represent you when you buy that property.
Exactly, right? I know. We're gonna get some investment properties, save some money. Mm-hmm. But yeah, we were talking the last week, and we were just saying, I think our early 30s are gonna be the best years of our life. I think, because I turned 25 this year. She turns 23 next year. So
still really young, bro.
I think, 5 to 7 years, and then we'll be in a much different situation.
My lady and I say the same thing, man. My girlfriend and I have been together for coming up on 3 years now. And we have a very similar mindset. It seems very similar to what you and Diana have, where you have this vision, you both are for that same vision and that same mission, and you're going to accomplish it. It's going to happen. It's just a matter of time.
Right. No, it's totally.
It's great to have that, man. Not a lot of relationships are like that.
Yeah.
I feel like some of them are maybe a little more one-sided.
Yeah. No, I'm so glad we're on the same page. It makes doing this, everything that I'm doing and that she's doing, like, every day, it just seems like, wow, we are building toward this goal, you know? Because if one of us had a certain mindset and the other didn't, there's a lot of relationships that are like that. Like, not everybody's going to be in a relationship and you have the same mindset and the same goals and stuff like that. But it sure makes it a hell of a lot better.
Oh, yeah. It makes it way easier. And it's nice when you're on that same mission and you're accomplishing your goals together. Right. It just feels good. Like, you're a team. At the end of the day, you're just a team.
Yep.
And you're going to win.
Yeah.
Power couple.
Yep. And yes, you want to spend as much time with each other, but you're not gonna hate each other for having to do certain things that you have to do to work towards those goals.
Yeah, so there's sacrifices that have to be made for sure.
Yeah,
it's like, you know, you've told me about late nights here at the office where you're here for, you know, God knows how long. You're up, who knows how late, dude, just grinding away. But
sleeping here,
it'll pay off. It'll pay off. You'll look back on this and it'll be like, man, I was really doing that.
Yep.
We'll look back 5 years from now and be like, wow, like, I saw the vision those guys had and it all came true. I'm a big believer in the law of attraction.
Yep.
Huge.
Yep.
I don't know if you are, man, but
I am.
If you can see it in your head, I'm stealing a Conor McGregor quote right now and probably butchering it, but if you can see it in your head, you'll see it before your eyes. And every night before I go to bed, sometimes I'll do it in the morning too, but usually before night, I have this notebook, right? It's my law of attraction notebook. I write down what's going to happen, what I'm going to do, how I'm going to do it, when is it going to happen, and all of it comes true.
Damn.
I mean, there's some things that haven't happened quite yet, but I'd say like 80% of the stuff comes true, man. Yeah. It's very powerful.
Yeah. Do you have any nightmare stories since you've been in real estate? I know a lot of agents do. You haven't been in the business as long as some people have, yeah. But there's always nightmare stories, right? So if you have something, I'm sure that I would love to hear and the audience would love to hear. So
I have a couple I can think of off the top of my head. I've been in the business for a few years now, so I have a couple. Luckily, nothing like awful where it's like, oh my God, how did that happen? But I have a couple funny ones. So as an agent, I know some agents don't door knock, but some do. Some will go out. Maybe it's like before an open house, you'll hand out some flyers.
Right.
Or you'll just door knock around a new listing, seeing, you know, if anybody needs help or knows anybody want to come to the neighborhood. And I want to say this was probably like the first 6 months I got my license. And I was out door knocking. It's not like door knocking is some foreign thing to me. I did it when I would try to wash cars when I was a kid, so it's not a big deal.
Yeah.
But I walk up to this one house, and the garage door is like halfway open. I'm like, maybe someone's like hanging out in here. It looked kind of weird. Like, I don't know, just looked like an odd garage. Like they had a bunch of food like stacked up, like it was like end of the world's coming or something. But yeah, I go to knock on the door, and I don't think the guy answers, but when I'm walking back to the sidewalk to head off to the next house, like the rest of the garage opens up and I look back and I was like, oh, hey, how you doing? Say whatever, introduce myself. And he started saying, okay, okay, okay. Like just repeatedly saying it. And I was like, all right, yeah, have a good one. Like just repeatedly kept saying, okay, did I think like mess with me? And he's like, he said something like, hey, like if you don't get out of here, I'm gonna shoot you. And I was like, yeah, I'm already leaving. Like, have a good one. He's like, okay, okay, okay. And I'm like, all right, cool. On to the next house.
Head, like, yeah, he was on drugs or something?
I mean, I assume that mentally the guy was probably unstable, not all there. Yeah, if you're just threatening to shoot some guy knocking on your door, you're probably not all there. And I wasn't in, like, the hood. Like, I wasn't, like, some crazy bad neighborhood. It was, like, an okay place. It wasn't, like, amazing, but it wasn't bad either. But that's one. Another one I have, too. This was on, I want to say, this is probably like my second listing because I had a couple canceled before, but this was the first listing that had actually closed. Mm-hmm. And so this was interesting. So once again, not a terrible place. It was an okay neighborhood. And the day before the house closes, I get a call from the buyer's agent, or it was a text. I think it was a text saying like, call me. And then she actually called me and she was like, hey, the house got broken into last night. It was a vacant house. It wasn't staged. Like there was nothing in there to take. The inside was like not the cleanest, nicest place in the world, but the house got broken into and the door got kicked down and they're going to need a new door. Mm. And just as a new agent and being younger, not being in the business for a super long time, like that was kind of scary because you're like, I don't know what happens here.
What
like,
do I do now?
What happens if a house gets broken into? But luckily everything was fine. The agent wasn't like the nicest in the world, but I probably wouldn't have been too happy either if the house got broken into because that your buyers are probably like, whoa, why are you putting me in this place? Like,
right.
What's going on? But it does happen. Like houses do get broken into, especially if they sit vacant for a while.
Yeah.
It's not the most uncommon thing in the world I've found out where it's like people are going to, especially if it's staged, some people might go in there, try to steal something. If some work's being done and some tools are laid out, people might jump in and try to take the tools.
Yeah. I mean, vacant properties, like when I do it, I always try to, you know, if I'm leaving, I try to close the blinds and make sure everything's obviously like leaving a porch light on and stuff is good, but
totally
having activity. If you're listing something and it's vacant, then and you're not going there very often and there's not a lot of foot traffic in and out, then people might be like, this is an opportunity to do something.
Exactly. Yeah.
So even just having like a family member go and like stop by or something.
Yeah, exactly. You know? Like go take pictures of the house or go outside. Have a son
in high school or something and be like, oh, just go drop this off.
Those were the only two like real like bad stories I can think of. But what about you? Do you have any like horror stories from clients or events? Like,
dude, I what are some so that stand many. Out? I have so many. I have so many that I can't even break it. Well, I have a few. Okay. I mean, there's some that definitely stand out. You know, a lot of them have been in real estate. Some of them have been just with bigger projects in real estate, and people not, you know, going along with the contract and telling me that I didn't do things that, you know, should have been on the contract, and they would have never signed it if that was the case, and blah 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 blah. Like, just a lot of bull crap that people just wanted to get out of paying money. So I've had a lot of situations like that. And then just going to some real estate listings, there's a few agents that I work with that get some pretty crazy homeowners or tenants. If it's owned by someone else and they have tenants living there, there has been some pretty weird situations. Like, okay, for instance, one which was like 2 weeks ago probably, and actually Luis was with me on this. Okay. One, it was his the first listing with me, and we go to the home, and me and him are standing outside the door with the agent. Okay. And we were out there for probably 5-10 minutes just sitting at the door. She's home. I don't know why it would take that long to open the door. Anyway, she finally opens the door. The house was not nice. There was like boxes and just random shit everywhere. Like, she had coverings on the table, but
okay,
don't really know why. But she wanted us to take our shoes off. Okay, like, the house wasn't even that nice.
It was so already kind of
like,
dirty.
I'm like, okay, you care about us taking the shoes off, but you don't care about your house looking good for pictures. Anyway, all right, cool. Sure. Sounds good. But it was scary, dude. When we went to her bedroom, none of the lights were on when we got there. So I'm like, okay, I'm great. I'm going to have to go and open the blinds. So I go into her room, and I open the blinds, and I'm coming to exit, and I turn the light on, and she comes over, and she's like, what are you doing in here? And I said I was turning the light on, blinds open. She's like, you're supposed to ask me to come into my room before you come in here. You need my permission. She said, for all you know, I could have a gun. And I was like, okay. Like, that's you weird. Knew we were coming here.
Yeah.
You knew we were coming here today. And it's just, I don't know. It sucks because, like, I want to put the blame on my agent for not, like, dealing with that ahead of time, but there's some people that just are crazy.
Yeah.
Just crazy. He actually told me, I think it was yesterday, that it ended up falling through with that. Terrible. He told me that she, so we left and gave him the photos. I think they were going to list it, and she randomly accused him of stealing the listing agreement. And he responded back to her and said, why would I steal the listing agreement if I have the main copy myself? And just started accusing him of weird stuff. So, yeah, that one was recent. I've had a lot more, but that's time for another day. So,
hey, that's the fun part about business, I guess. You never know who you're going to work with, right. Never know who you're going to meet.
But. Yeah.
This has been fun, man. Thank you for having me on. I appreciate it.
Yeah, man.
I love the office. I love the setup.
Thank you.
I love your team, man. It's just, this has been super fun.
Yeah, I'm glad you came. We'll definitely have you back. You know, somewhere down the line.
Yeah,
and see what's happened since now.
So. I'll definitely see you in between that.
Cool.
For sure.
Oh yeah, duh. Come on now.
Yep.
Maybe get Jared.
Jared, maybe. Yeah.
Shout out Jared.
The stock guy.
All right, guys. Thank you for tuning in.